Is it important to you how previous funds were spent by any office?
Oh, absolutely. That's very important. We need to know how previous funds were spent so that we're able to program funds in the future. I mean, that's obvious.
All right. Now, and because you said that, what is your opinion then on the transfer of the funds from the Office of the President to the Office of the Vice President? The amount is staggering. It's 221.424 million pesos, which includes the 125 million in confidential and intelligence funds. Is that something that you are going to scrutinize come the plenary debates?
Yes, that's going to be part of it. Yes,
but Congresswoman, is it what is your opinion regarding that transfer?
Well, so far it would seem that everything is legal. There was a transfer of 125 million out of the contingent fund of the president, and this was transferred to the office of the vice president in 2022. Mm-hmm. And these were all transparent. It's seen in the NEP of 2024. And it was stated on record by the COA that these were properly liquidated.
But was it right? It may be legal, but was it right? Congresswoman, what do you say to what former Senate President Franklin Drilon said, that the power to augment cannot be used to fund non-existing items in the budget? The CAFs, they weren't there during the deliberations before it was passed. Go ahead, Congresswoman.
Well, that's not my take on it, because the line item already existed. So the line item, which is confidential and intelligence funds, already existed in 2022. It just so happened that the amount was zero. So you can actually augment an item because the item already existed. It just so happened the amount was zero.
How does this not set a dangerous precedent, even if you see it that way, that all other agencies will just put an item there? Go ahead.
Carmina, the item exists.
Right.
The item already existed. So it happened. Let's set the record straight. I mean, we need to understand there are two things here. An item existing, meaning the item which is confidential and intelligence funds, already existed in 2022, but the amount was zero. Okay. So yung item, which is the title, existed. Okay, the amount, which is the appropriated amount, is zero, was zero in 2022.
Uh-huh. Which brings me to the question, Congresswoman, what now prevents other agencies from doing exactly
And then at any point in time, you are allowed, any agency is allowed to do interagency transfers. Any agency for that matter is allowed interagency transfers. That's allowed.
Yeah. It is allowed, allowed, Congresswoman. I'm sorry,
but those interagency transfers can be seen in the NEP.
Yeah,
you can see that.
We understand that.
It just so happens that such transfer happened between OP and the OVP, and it was reflected in the NEP 2024. And you can see that there are multiple kinds of interagency transfers across many agencies. If you look at the NEP, Carmina, there are many such interagency transfers. There are many such kinds of transfers. It is not unique to this kind of a transfer. And I assure you, Carmina, that is not the only kind of interagency transfer in the NEP 2024. There are many, many, many kinds of such interagency transfers.
All right. Now that you've said that, you have former Senate President Franklin Drilon saying there must be some intervention here before things get out of hand. To his mind, things are already getting out of hand. There's one intervention that he said that maybe no further CIF funds will be released until, you know, a report is given to the Oversight Committee just to make sure that the funds are being spent well. What do you think about that?
We've checked all reports that need to be submitted, and all such reports have been submitted. So, for example, the report to the Office of the Speaker had been submitted. Mm-mm. So, as far as we are concerned, they've been compliant.
Okay, because they're also...
And AGOA had also put that on record. Mm. So, of course, I have no idea what are in those reports because of the nature of the fund, which is confidential. Mm. So I have access to those reports.
Exactly.
So I don't know what, so, but as to compliance, I can assure you that they are compliant, as stated by COA. And I can tell you that that they had submitted to Congress.
Okay. The president, in his last State of the Nation address, cited education as foundation for a strong nation. With the current state of the education budget, is it reflective of the president's sentiments?
I believe so.
You think it is? What is your concern, or do you have any concerns about the cuts, for example, in the budget of the SUCs? And is there something else that can be done regarding this once the plenary debates begin?
Yes. So again, the plenary debates are just about to begin on September 18. And amendments are yet to be made, Carmina. So, marami pang pwedeng improvements ang gawin. So, let's not make any premature judgments at this point, Carmina.
Sa parte po ng DOH, halimbawa, before we got to end, there were a lot of sectors belonging, or a lot of groups belonging to the health sector already airing their concerns about the cut for the health department. What kind of change do you think is possible in the realm of possibilities regarding the budget of the health department, Congresswoman?
Yes, so historically, Carmina, the NEP is of the DOH is always lower than the GAA amounts. In other words, historically, Congress always increases the budget of the DOH. Mm-hmm. So. Again, I don't want to make a premature statement, but I am very, very optimistic that Congress will propose increases in the budget of the DOH.
Also for the Education Department or the SUCs?
I am, again, also optimistic, but I don't want to make a premature statement at this point, because remember, typically we will be on the part of Congress, our target date to approve the budget is end September.
All right, let's go to House Bill 9030. Let's give our viewers an overview here before we continue. It seeks to empower the president to declare a state of national rice emergency, pay out rice subsidies, authorize limited imports by the NFA, zero tariffs for all rice imports, and prescribe penalties for acts of rice economic sabotage. Which sector, Congresswoman, will the House bill, or does this bill aim to help?
It's actually a comprehensive toolkit, right? So it's actually more, it's permissive, so it allows the executive to help consumers, farmers, and actually other suppliers, meaning even traders if necessary, so long as, for example, traders end up facing operating losses. as in the current situation, as a result of the mandated price ceilings, for example. So in a situation, for example, right now, as a result of the price ceilings, if because of the price ceilings, for example, retailers are unwilling to let go of their stocks, then if the executive needs to give subsidies to them, then at this point in time, then the bill authorizes them to subsidize the retailers.
The bill, the proposal looks at zero tariffs for rice imports, Congresswoman?
Again, under very specific conditions. For example, one, that the tariff targets have been met. So for example, annually, the tariff revenue targets would be something like 10 billion pesos, because every year, tariff revenues are returned to farmers in the form of assistance. Mm. So once that have been met, and in the case of tariff suspension, if in case landed costs would be greater than the mill cost, mm-hmm. then that would be a case where we can argue for the suspension of tariffs.
Oh.
In other words, masyado nang mahal ang imports, so then maybe we can just suspend the tariffs.
How do you then ease the fears of that this proposal may just lead to, you know, imports flooding the market once again to the detriment of our very own farmers, Congresswoman?
So, well, okay, right now, there could be, according to the DA, as reported to Congress, they feel like local supply could be short, and therefore we need to import, right? So even if bilhin na natin lahat ng local produce, kulang pa rin ang supply para sa demand, and therefore we would need to import rice, mm. right? So so in that situation, therefore, it's very clear that we would need to import, right? So just to assuage our farmers, of course, uunahin natin bilhin ang local supply.
Mm-mm.
So it's then that we will bring in the imports, mm-hmm. right? And, the second way to assure our farmers, of course, is that revenues of our tariff revenues will again be given back to our farmers in the form of assistance, mm-hmm. right? So those are the two ways to assure our farmers that that first and foremost, it is very important that we need to enhance their productivity, because at the end of the day, it's very important that they are competitive against the cheaper imports. But remember, Carmina, at this point in time, rice imports are actually more expensive than our local rice.
Mm-mm. All right, back to the budget now. Speaker Martin Romualdez in the beginning said he's giving you guys a 5-week period to finish a budget. Is this achievable? Where are you at this point?
Well, at this point, we need about 4 more days for the budget briefings before we begin plenary debates. We are on track.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Congresswoman Stella Kimbo there, Appropriations Senior Vice Chairperson as well, and 2nd District Representative of Marikina. Thanks a lot for taking our Zoom call today. Take care.